Hello guys, I'm Rashvit. In today's video, we are going to revise last chapter of CA Inter Strategic Management, that is chapter number 8, Strategy Implementation and Control. So, for the remaining chapters, you can go and check in CA Dreams. In this channel, I have uploaded all the remaining 7 chapters. For full lectures, please go and visit my channel. Accounting secrets. And if you like the video, please share with your friends, as well as please subscribe the channel Accounting Secrets as well as CA Dreams. Okay, now coming to the topic, we have 7 topics in this chapter, only 7 topics, and there might be a chances of more MCQs from this chapter. So let's see what are the different topics we are going to cover in this chapter. One is strategy implementation, relationship between implementation and formulation, and strategic change, strategic control, strategy audit, business process reengineering, and benchmarking. So, first, if we see strategic implementation is nothing but putting a strategy into course of action. That is, strategy implementation consists of managerial exercise. It is managerial exercise. It is not a normal activity or operational activity. It is a managerial activity of putting a freshly chosen strategy. That is, we will be available with the numerous of strategies. And out of that, we will select appropriate one. And that comes in decision making. The selecting one appropriate one is known as decision making. And we are going to put it into action. It will be called as strategy implementation. It deals with the managerial exercise of supervising the ongoing pursuit of strategy, making it work, improving the competency with which it is executed, and showing measurable progress and achieving the targeted results. It is nothing but you are going to exercise, managerial exercise, and you will supervise your strategy and bring some changes, and you will make sure that it will help you in progressing your organization. And in implementing strategy, allocating of resources is required, because to implement anything, you have to allocate resource for that particular thing. For example, my strategy is to marketing. Now, I came up with marketing strategy. To implement that marketing strategy, I have to spend amount. See, the allocation of resources to new course of action will need to be undertaken, and there may be a need for adopting the organization structure. So whenever you want to bring a strategy into action, then you have to change your organization structure if it is not supportive to that particular strategy. This is said by Chandler. We learnt in chapter number 7. To handle new activities as well as to train a personnel. So, bringing a new strategy, again the new challenge is that you have to train your personnel for that particular new strategy and devising appropriate system. Implementing strategy affects an organization from top to bottom, because whole organization structure will change. It affects all the function and divisional areas of the business. Whenever the structure change, obviously function and divisional areas will change. There is a chance that simple structure comes to functional structure, or functional structure to divisional structure, division to multi-divisional, SBU. So whenever structure changes, the functional activities, divisional activities, everything will be affected, and also organization will be affected from top to bottom. Okay, now let's see what is the relationship between implementation and formulation. Formulation is, we know, that is theoretical aspect. Implementation, that is practical approach. In theoretical aspect, you will formulate a strategy by considering the external environment and internal environment. In implementation, you are going to implement that selected and developed strategy. Strategic management process does not end when the firm decides what strategy to pursue. So, strategic management process will not end when firm formulates the strategy. It will end after implementing and after changing, if there is any necessity, and after controlling, after auditing, etc. And again, if there is any changes, again you will formulate new strategy. So strategic management is a never ending process. it will go till organization goes. This requires support of all managers and employees of the business. So implementing strategy is not that easy. It requires help of managers as well as subordinates. Managers to guide and subordinates to implement it. It is crucial to realize the difference between the two, because they both require very different skills. Whereas for formulation, you should be having the knowledge of external environment as well as internal environment, and you should be of great mind. Whereas for implementation, you should be knowing the strength and weakness of your organization and your employees, and you should be knowing how to implement it effectively. So it requires a different kind of skill set. A company will be successful only when the strategy formulation is sound. So the formulated strategy is good and implementation is excellent. So obviously firm will get succeeded. Organization success is a function of good strategy and a proper implementation. So organization structure will not come only by good formulation or by proper implementation. It will be the blend of two, mixture of two, formulation as well as excellent implementation. The matrix in the figure below represent a various combination of strategy formulation and implementation. So it will show if formulation is weak, implementation is strong, what you have to do. Formulation is strong, implementation is weak, what you have to do. So all this matrix will explain. See, strategic formulation, sound, that is strong and flawed, is weak. And strategy implementation, weak and excellent. So square A represent strategy formulation is good, but implementation is false. So at this time, if an organization finds out where we are going wrong in implementing, and if they correct it, then they will certainly achieve their objective. If not, then it will be of no use. See, square A, company will aim at moving from square A to square B. That is, both are good. Even they realize their implementation difficulties. If they realize and if they come back with a solution for their implementation difficulties, then they will come from A to B. Now comes the question, what exactly B is? B is strategy formulation is good and strategy implementation is excellent. That is what all organizations want, and that is ideal situation. Okay, now comes C. Strategy formulation is weak as well as implementation is also weak. Then you have to readjust the whole organization. Beginning from formulation, you have to formulate a new strategy as well as you have to implement it in a better way. You should try to implement it in a better way. See, their path to success goes through business model redesign. That is, you have to redesign your whole business model and implementation and execution readjustment. In simple, you have to concentrate on both implementation as well as formulation. Square D is implementation is excellent, but formulation is weak. Company has to redesign their strategy before readjusting implementation or execution skill. So you have to readjust your formulation skill and you have to bring up with new formulation. So bring strategy, that is new strategy, so that you will go to B from D. Okay, there is another approach to decide what exactly strategy formulation and what exactly, you know, implementation will affect an organization. See, strategy formulation, we call it as effective and ineffective. Effective means whether that is matching to our requirements, whether it is bringing, attracting customer towards it. See, finally, competitive strategy, what is our goal? One, to attract customer. Two, to cover the whole market, that is to capture the market. Three, to get out from the competitive disadvantage. So if all these things are satisfied, then we call that strategy as effective. If it is not satisfying those three conditions, we call it as ineffective. Now comes operational management, that is day-to-day activity, efficient and inefficient. Efficiency is nothing but that is based on your input and output. If your input is small and if your output generation is big, then we call it as more efficient. And if output is more and input is less, if output is less and input is more, we call it as inefficient. See, efficiency. the relationship between inputs and outputs, usually with a short time horizon. See, efficiency, it will be for the short span of time, not for the long run. But effectiveness, if it is effective now, it will be effective for long run in the organization. It will help in the long run in an organization. So effectiveness, which is concerned with the attainment of organization goal, including that of desired competitive position. See, if your operation is doing good, that is you are efficient as well as your strategy which you formulated is effective, then you can grow, that is thrive. Your strategy formulation is ineffective, but your work is good, your work is efficient, which means in the short run you will earn profit, but in future you go for loss, because of which we say that in this condition industry will, sorry, not industry, firm will die slowly. Next comes, your strategy formulation is effective, but your operational management is inefficient, which means in short run you are earning a loss, you are making a loss, but you have a future, that is your implementation is proper, customer know about you, that is your formulation is effective. So now you might struggle, but in future days you might increase your efficiency, because of which you will survive in a industry, in an industry. Now comes, formulation is ineffective as well as you are inefficient, which means you do not have long run as well as you are in short run also you are making a loss, which means you will die quickly, that is you will liquidate your organization. Okay, now it is to be noted that division of strategy management into different phases is only for purpose of orderly study. See, we divide strategy formulation and strategy implementation, that is only for studies, but your strategy implementation and strategy formulation go hand in hand, which means after strategy implementation there might be strategy formulation, again after strategy formulation again strategy implementation, it is a cycle. See, for strategy implementation and strategy formulation there will be two kind of linkages. One is a forward linkage, other way is backward linkage. With the formulation of new strategies or reformation of existing strategy, many change have to be affected within the organization. So once you formulate the strategy, in future you have to restructure your whole organization, you have to come up with some efficient people, so many things will change, that will be called as forward linkage. That is, for strategy formulation there are other activities which are linked in future, that is forward. Also there is a backward linkage. See, organization tend to opt those strategies which can be implemented with the help of a present structure of resource combined with the some additional effort. So you will check last time how you implemented strategy, whether it's working, why it's not working, or why it's working, and also you will think what are our resources, and last time how you implemented. So last time's implementation will help to formulate a strategy, current strategy, because you can't change the whole organization. You should keep something in common. So by keeping those things in common, which means you are formulating strategy based on old things, which means based on earlier implementation. So we call it as backward linkages. Okay, now our third topic is strategic change. That is, if you think that your strategy is not working, then you go for change your strategies to some extent, not much. The change in the environment forces often require business to make a modification in their existing strategies and bring out new strategies. So we know that environment is dynamic, so it asks us to change our strategies along with the environment. Strategic change is complex process that involves a corporate strategy focused on new markets, products, services, and new way of doing business. So it is a complex force, complex, you know, thing, process. Strategy change, strategic change is a complex process, because it might ask you to change your product strategy, marketing strategy, service strategy, the whole way you are doing the business. So it is a complex activity. Okay, what are the different steps taken while changing the strategy? First one is recognize the need for change. You have to recognize whether our current strategy is doing good. If no, we have to recognize why it's not doing good, and we have to check what are the requirements is required, you know, what are the requirements are expecting from the new strategy, that is change strategy. So you should recognize the change for need for change. Create a shared vision to manage change. So you have to communicate it with your employees, and you have to make them understand, and you have to try to match their objective along with the organizational objective. So it is creating a shared vision to manage change. Finally, institutionalize the change. So final, after changing everything, after changing mindset of your employees, etc., you will make it as final and it will become normal. Now change is normal. Okay. Kurt Lewins gave one more model for change. First one is unfreezing the situation. Here what you will do is you will make your employees to understand there is a need for change. There is a need for change. That is unfreezing process. Unfreezing the situation. Next, changing to new situation. So when employees understand there is a need for change, what he will do? He will make sure that he will change for that particular requirement. So changing to the new strategy situation. After that, next thing is refreezing. That is, you will make that particular strategic change into normal. Next comes our fourth topic, that is a strategic control. See, we learnt in class 12, controlling is nothing but we will set our predetermined goal and we will measure our current performance, compare with predetermined, and if there is any deviations, check why it is and try to change that particular thing to reduce your deviation. So deviation might be positive as well as negative. If it's positive, what you will do, you will increase your goal, whereas if it is negative, you do not decrease your goal. If it is ideal, what you will do, you will try to improve your performance. Now, controlling is the function intended to ensure and make possible the performance of the planned activities and to achieve the predetermined goals and activities. The controlling function involves monitoring the activity and measuring results against the pre-established standards. So what are the things involved in controlling? First one is, it is an activity and measuring the result, that is actual result, against the pre-established standards, that is pre-established goals, and analyzing whether is there any deviation and correcting deviation if there are any, and maintaining or adapting the system, that is maintaining the same system or bringing some changes to make sure that from next time there will not be a much deviation. Okay, what are the elements included in process? Objective of business system which could be operationalized into measurable and controllable standards. So you have to set a standard based on measurable and controllable thing. It should be measurable and controllable. A mechanism for monitoring and measuring the performance of the system. So you have to come up with a new mechanism to control that. Next one is a mechanism. First one, for comparing the actual results with the reference to standards. So we'll come up with one mechanism which will compare actual and standard for detecting deviation from the standard. Next mechanism is to, after comparing, measuring is there any deviation. After that, learning a new sets of standards themselves. So if there is any deviation, coming up with certain changes. For all these things, you have to set one mechanism. A mechanism for feedback, corrective and adaptive information and instruction to the system for effective desired change to set right the system to keep it in on course. Okay. There are three type of organizational control. They are operational control. That is, you are controlling day-to-day activity. There might be on the basis of functions like production, this much should be your goal and you achieved only this much, and for that deviation what is the reason. This will be operational. And managemental, it is nothing but you are controlling your management things. You are allotted this much resources and you are expecting this much return, but if that return is not coming, why? And final one is a strategic control, that is controlling your strategy. Now comes operation control. The thrust of operation control is on individual tasks and transactions as against total or more aggregative management function. So they are based on a single, task or single function. As I already said, production. If sales, this much should be sales, and we achieved this much sales, and if there is any difference, why? And we have to bring certain corrective changes. Many of the control system in organization are operational and mechanistic in nature. That is, there is no need for someone to check it. They are mechanistic. Like today, we have to produce 100 units. If we produce 98 units, automatically it will show deviation of 2. A set of standards, plans, and instructions are formulated. The control activity consists of regulating the process within certain tolerance. That is, we will set one tolerance level like 5% and all. Now my target is to go for 100 and my tolerance level is 5%. Now if we produce 95 plus, then there will be no issue. There will be no deviation. But if we go below that, it will show you as, you know, there is a negative deviation. Okay. Irrespective of the effects of external conditioning on the formulated standards, plans, and instructions. See, if we set that particular tolerance level and we mechanize it, for example, earlier, every time, every day, 100 units we used to produce. Because of coronavirus, COVID-19 breakdown, what government said is, you have to give work for only 50% employees. Because of which, now I am producing only 50 units. As my mechanism is already set, it will give a tolerance level in 5%, which means if you produce less than 95%, it will show it as negative deviation. Now, because of external environment, I have potential. 50%, 50 units means in 100%, I can surely produce 100 units. But now government is not allowed. That is, there is some changes in external environment. Inevitable. So, but now it will not understand that. That mechanism will not understand it. It will show what? It is show it have show you as negative deviation. Because you already configured the particular limit in your system. Next comes the management control. The process by which manager assures the resources are obtained and used effectively and efficiently in the accomplishment of the organizational objective. So in this particular control, management will make sure that they obtained the resources in a good manner. That is, their interest rate might be less, or in the that particular resource is optimal. That is, they are paying less interest, something like that. And they will make sure that it is used effectively, and it will help in accomplishing the organizational objective. This will come in management control. In simple, you are making sure that the fund you obtained as well as used, and making sure that your organizational objectives are satisfied. So this will be work of management control. Now comes the strategic control. See, strategic control is the process of evaluating strategy as it is formulated and implemented. See, while formulating or implementing, there might be some changes. Like while formulating, COVID-19 was not there. While implementing, COVID-19 was there. Which means external environment is not same. When external environment is not same, your formulated strategy will differ the result which you are expecting after implementing. So sometimes you have to evaluate your implementation and formulation. You have to check whether the target is reaching. That will be called as strategic control. It is directed towards identifying problems and changes in premise and making necessary adjustments. Strategic control focus on the dual question. The strategy is being implemented as planned. So here strategic control, we check two things. One, whether strategy is implemented as formulated, as we planned earlier. The result produced by the strategy are those intended. That is, one, implementation is proper. Still, whether because of that particular implementation, whether our result, what we are getting, is as expected. That is, whether we are reaching our goal. These things we will consider in strategic control. And if there is any deviations, we go for strategic change. Okay, there are four kind of strategic control. First one is premise control. Here we check environment, external environment, and we will check some assumptions. We assumed while formulating a strategy, we assumed certain things. We assumed our GDP will be this much, inflation rate will be this much. And now in for premise control, we will check again whether the thing what we assumed is there in an exact market. If it's not there, we will bring certain changes. That will be called as premise control. Next is strategic surveillance. That is, here we are going to check something which we are not considered while formulating the strategy. That is day-to-day improvements in an industry. That is day-to-day changes in an industry. It might be from the magazines, it might be from the newspapers, etc. Next is special alert control. That is, suddenly there might be a requirement for some changes in a strategy or in a organization or in the environment, like your earthquake, natural calamities, terrorist attack, etc. For example, COVID-19, because of which now you have to change your whole strategy. This will be called as special alert control. Next is implementation control. That is, while implementing, we know that we ask two questions: whether result is same as expected, whether we implemented in the same manner as you expected. So we have to check whether we implemented in the same manner as we expected. That will be called as implementation control. Implementation control is directed towards assessing the need for changes in the overall strategy in the light of unfold events and results associated with the incremental steps and actions. That is, in future. The two basic forms of implementation control. There are two basic forms. First one is monitoring strategic thrust. Monitoring strategic thrust helps manager to determine whether the overall strategy is progressing as desired or whether there is need for readjustment. So here we will understand whether our strategy is asking something new or whether our strategy is need to be developed again, whether we our strategy need to be changed. All these things will be checked in monitoring strategic thrust. Next is milestone review. That is, we will divide a whole strategy based on time, based on result, etc. And we will check whether we are reaching that particular milestone. If we are not reaching, we have some deviation. Okay. Now our fifth concept, that is strategic audit. See, it is same as your strategic control, but the thing is, here it is not a day-to-day basis. Strategic control, operational control, day-to-day basis. Strategic control whenever you implement and formulate a strategy. And you know, management control while you allocate resources, obtain resources, that time. But strategic control for a period of time, for 3 months once, 6 months once, you will check again. Here also you will check whether your strategy is working as you expected. Okay. A strategic audit is an examination and evaluation of areas affected by the operation of the strategic management process within an organization. So it is examination and evaluation of which area, the areas which are affected by the strategic management process. That is nothing but the areas for which we formulated and implemented a strategy. Okay. The strategy audit secures that all necessary information for the development of the company are included in the business plan and the management supports it. That is, it will make sure that we are in the track. That is, we obtained all the requirements, we have all the data, and we formulated our strategy based on those particular data. A strategy audit is needed under the following circumstances. For following circumstances, strategy audit is needed. So whenever the strategy audit is needed, let's check. When the performance indicator reflects that the strategy is not working properly or it's not producing desired outcomes. So whenever you come to know that you are not achieving your desired objectives, your desired outcomes, and your work is not going that smoothly, you know, if there is any conflict between the management, you change the management, but still the conflict is getting continued. So all this thing will make tell you that your strategy which you implemented itself is wrong. So it will ask us to audit our strategy, that is examine our strategy or examine our activities where strategic management process is there. When the goals and objectives of a strategy are not being accomplished, so when strategic goals, you know, and objectives are not accomplished, we will have to audit our strategy when the major change takes place in the external environment of the organization. So which means we have to go for major change in our strategy also, because strategy is formulated based on internal environment as well as external environment. So we are, whenever external environment change, we have to change our strategy also. So we have, there is a necessity for strategy audit. Strategy audit includes three basic activities. What are those? Examining the underlying base of a firm strategy. That is, examining how we formulated the current strategy. what are the things we considered while formulating the current strategy, comparing the expected results with the actual results. That is same as controlling. You will control, you will compare your current result with the standard result, taking the corrective actions to ensure that the performance conforms to plan. Okay, now Richard Reumert's criteria for strategy cult. He gave certain criteria for strategy cult. First one is consistency. See, your goals and policies should be consistent. That is, your strategy should help you always in achieving your goals and policies. Then we can say that strategy is good. If it is inconsistent, there is a need for strategic alt. Consonance. Consonance refers to the need for strategists to examine set of trends as well as individual trends in alting strategies. A strategy must represent an adaptive response to the external environment and the critical changes occurring within it. So, whenever there will be a change in the related terms, for example, whenever there is a change in the trend of substitutes, or whenever there is a change in your current product only, then you should go for changing your strategy. That is, you should start auditing your strategy, because your current strategy will not give you a expected result. Next one is feasibility. A strategy must neither overtax available resource nor create unsolvable sub problems. So your strategy should be feasible. If it is not, that is applicable. If it is not applicable, that is, you have a resource of 10 lakh. That strategy, particular strategy, asking for a resource of 13 lakh, which means it is not feasible. So strategy should be feasible. If it is not feasible, you have to audit your strategy and you should come up with a new strategy or some strategic changes. Next one is advantage. That is, the strategy which you implement should give you a advantage. That is, we learned competitive advantage, that kind, in which things, resources, it should give you advantage in skills, you should give you advantage in market position, it should give you a advantage. If it is not giving you advantage, then you should go for strategic audit. Next comes our sixth topic, business process reengineering. In simple, in a business process reengineering, what you do is you will restructure the whole business process, or major business process, not small changes, whole business process only. Then question comes, what exactly business process means? Business process is nothing but the set of activities which you will do, the set of activities which you will do to convert input into output. So from raw material to finished goods, whatever the process you do, that will be called as a business process. So if we bring major changes in that particular process to achieve our organizational objective, we call it as business process reengineering. Okay, business process reengineering, that is BPR, refers to the analysis and redesign of the workflow of the processes both within and between the organization. Okay, a process, what exactly business process means? Now, a process is a set of logically related tasks or activities oriented towards achieving the specified outcome. So it is nothing but it is a task and activities which are oriented towards achieving our organizational objectives. It is a collection of activities which creates an output of value to the customer and often transcends departmental or functional boundaries. So it is nothing but it is the activity which brings input into output. Okay, there are certain core processes. What are exactly core processes? Core processes are nothing but the processes which are crucial, which are critical for your success. So based on that particular effectiveness of that particular process, your organization structure is depending, then we call it as core processes. See, some processes turn out to be extremely critical. They are extremely critical for the success and survival of the enterprise. So all these things are called as core processes. Core business processes are critical in the company's evaluation by its customers. So customers usually consider the particular thing for evaluating your business. For example, if you take an online e-commerce thing, Amazon, Flipkart and all, we usually judge based on discount. We select where we have to purchase. Based on discount, one thing. Next one is delivery period. That is, which will deliver more and more quickly. You know, packaging might be, packing whether it's good or not. So these are certain critical processes which we concentrate. We call it as core process. So customer decision will be basically based on these particular processes. BPR focuses on such critical business process out of many processes that go on in any company. BPR is an approach to unusual improvement. This is not a usual improvement, or it is not, you know, expecting a moderate return. It needs a huge return. It is expecting to get a huge return because you are changing in a unusual manner. You are changing your organization in a unusual manner, which means you are changing from A to Z. You are changing, you are scrapping your old process and bringing up the new process. Business process re-engineering means starting all over, starting from scratch. Okay, there are certain elements of business process re-engineering. What are those? Re-engineering begins with the fundamental rethinking. That is, you have to think. If we are doing certain process, why we are doing that particular process? Okay, you will get the answer. We are doing that particular process because we have to get this particular outcome. Okay, next question is, you have to check why you are doing that particular thing in that manner only. For example, you are at Amazon. Manufacturer, Amazon, consumer. Now, Amazon, what they did is, manufacturer will directly send goods to your customer. Their customer. Now, Amazon should think, what exactly we are doing? How our process is running? That is, our manufacturer, it is our partner, will send the goods to customer. Fine. We have to think, why we are doing in that manner? You are doing in that manner because it will save time, because it should come to Amazon and later go to customer. It will save time because it directly go from manufacturing to customer, as well as it reduces the cost. Now, if you come across some demerits, like packing mistakes are there, some packing is not that good, then you might restructure, like why we are doing that, to reduce the cost. But now if customer only not come, there is no point of reducing the cost. So you might ask them to send it to you and you might send it to your customer. So this is the thing of fundamental rethinking, that you have to rethink. Re-engineering involves radical change designing of process. So you have to change your certain processes which are required to get change. Re-engineering aims to achieve a dramatic improvement in the performance. That, as I already said, it is not concentrating on earning a moderate return by changing. Because if you need some changes in the profit, don't go for re-engineering. Because it will make you as a new organization only. Your whole process will get changed. Process pertaining to development and delivery of the product and or service. This may be include research, design, engineering, manufacturing and logistics, decide purchases, procurement and material management. So here you have to bring certain changes in, it might be in research, design, etc. Processes involving interfaces with the customer. So they see three processes. One, within your organization. Next, communicating with your customer, that is interacting with your customer. Next, with the management activities. So in the first activities, there are certain processes. What are those? Manufacturing, logistics, you know, purchasing, etc. In customer interface activities, that is marketing, advertising, order fulfillment, service. All these are the certain processes. See, we divide the generic business process of a firm needing redesign may be classified into three broad categories. So processes which should be redesigned, we classify into three. One based on the process, that is developing a product. Next is satisfying customer, that is interface, communicating with your customer. Next is about all the management activities. Okay, process comprising management activities. This includes strategy formulation, planning, budgeting, performance measurement and reporting, human resource management. So all this, if there is any changes is required in all these processes, you will bring strategic re-engineering. Okay, the simple strategic re-engineering is scrapping your old process, bringing up the new process to come with the more effectiveness and with more efficiency. Okay, what are the steps involved in a BPR? First one, determine the objective. You have to determine why you have to re-engineer your process. You have to determine your objective. Next is identify customers and determine their need. Next, you have to identify who your customers are. And you have to identify their needs and you have to make sure that your current process which you are planning to bring, your, you know, changed processes will help your customers in satisfying their requirements. Study the existing process. Next, we have to study your existing process. That is what exactly we are doing. That is fundamental questioning. Formulating a redesign process plan. That is, next you have to formulate some new plan, formulate some new strategy, formulate some new process and implement those processes in your organization. Okay, what are the problems included in BPR? Re-engineering is a major radical improvement in the business process. So, it is a radical improvement. It is not a normal improvement. It is a radical, sudden improvement, which means you need so much resources. You need so much time. You know, it should change our whole organization process. So re-engineering involves time and expenditure. Setting up targets is tricky and difficult. So we learned while putting BPR into action, first step is to determine objective. That is, after changing particular process, how much we should achieve. So that setting process, that is not that easy. It is some tricky and it is difficult. Next thing comes, that is benchmarking. A benchmarking may be defined as a standard or a point of reference against which things may be compared and by which something can be measured and judged. See, it is a standard. Benchmark means standard. For example, if we take Amazon only, others e-commerce people sending customers orders within 5 to 6 days. Whereas Amazon sending 3 to 5 days. So for this, we will compare how industry is doing and how our firm is doing. This will be called as benchmark, and setting this industrial target will be known as benchmarking, which means the thing, our actual performance will be compared with something. That something will be known as benchmark. And setting up that something, that is setting a value for that something, will be known as benchmarking. In simple words, benchmarking is an approach of setting goals and measuring productivity based on a best industry practices. The scientific study conducted by a Frederick Taylor in the later part of the 19th century represent an early use of the benchmarking concept. So in 1890s, something like that, Taylor come up with this benchmarking concept. However, the term got popularity much later in the 7th decade of the 20th century. That is, in 1970s, this particular benchmarking got popularity. Okay, what are the steps involved in benchmarking process? The first step is identify the need for benchmarking. We have to identify why we should go for benchmarking. Because our organization is not doing in the manner we expected, which means our organization is not satisfying our needs. You know, our customer needs, our customers need something more, whereas industry is doing that. For example, industry is providing some product at rupees 10, but our cost itself is rupees 12. Now we have to compare it. That is, we have to think why we should compare, because our cost is more than industry, and we have to check why industry is doing so good, why we are failing in reducing our cost. So identify the need for benchmarking. Clearly understanding the existing business process. Later, you have to understand your current business process. Because of business process, you know, your same industry's activity will not match. So you have to analyze the current business process, how we are doing our business. Later, you should come up with the best process. That is, identify the best process and compare own processes and performance with that of others. That is, later you have to compare your performance with the industrial performance, and after that, if you are unsatisfied, then go for that best industrial practice. That is, change your current process to best industrial practice, best process. Finally, you have to prepare a report based on that, why the deviation is happening, what exactly your process and what exactly industry is doing in common, all these things, and implement the steps necessary to close the performance gap. That is, you have to implement that particular new, you know, best process so that you and your industry's process will get matched. Finally, you should evaluate whether your benchmarking and business reengineering process worked or not. Okay, here ends up our revision session. So, thank you for listening and all the best for your examination. And my small tip for your examination is, before going to your examination, at least take one or two model test papers, because without taking model test papers, you can't go and, you know, directly sit in exam and you can't write, because it will give you a lot of confusions to select the question and to write, how to write and all. And you will not be of the, you know, practice. See, finally, how much you shall, you know, study, but finally what matters is the day before examination, how you use, and also how you are well prepared to write the examination, more than what you have to write in the examination. That is, what you have in your mind to write in the examination, more than that, how you prepare to write the examination matters. So please don't forget to take one or two mock test papers. It might be available in ICA website also. That is also good. And try to self-evaluate it, because if other people evaluate it, what you will do? You will check one answer, two answer, and okay, why it's wrong, fine. And you will get bored and you will throw that paper aside. But if you self-evaluate, you will check your all the answers, because of which you come to know in which answer you did mistake and how you, why did you make a mistake, and you can correct it in real time itself, in that time itself, rather than going for other people's correction. Okay. And also, this particular study material, this revision notes, I prepared keeping ICAI study material in mind. That is, I extracted all the things from ICAI material only, because ICAI expect you to write in the manner in which ICAI study material gives you information, and answer key also, suggested answer will be also in the same manner. So I would suggest you to read this particular revision notes before your examination. It might come to 45-50 pages, not more than that, and you can complete it in a 3 to 4 hours. Okay, thank you for your support, and if you think this revision is useful, please share with your friends, and also please don't forget to subscribe CA Dreams as well as my channel Accounting Secrets, so that I can come up with some new subjects and new topics in the future days. And all the best for your examination. Thank you.